that's a great way to get material. You don't have to pay anything for it, right? But if you have to buy all your steel, you're probably going to spend more for 10, for 40 wood 40 than for 40 than for 10 45, and certainly more for a main brand steel like an Atlantic 33 or something like that. And if you're really comfortable using those materials, if you have a process you've already developed that works really well, and you know that you use that material with your process, you get an outcome you're happy with, then by all means, keep doing that. Like, that's a good process for you. But purely from a performance standpoint, a piece of 1045, probably even a piece of 1030, would work just fine for something like a hammer. And the reason is because a hammer doesn't need to be hard up. Okay, Bruce, remember. How's the forgeability of those different materials? That's your question? Right, so those materials that I just mentioned are all going to forge relatively similarly. There definitely are materials that are going to forge harder than others. So A13, S7, things that have high alloy content, they are going to take more power to move for a given temperature and cross section than something with less alloy content. If you have the right equipment, a large power hammer, a hydraulic press or something like that, that may be irrelevant to you, but if you're doing all hand work, you're going to notice that, and you might not want to take on the extra effort of dealing with those materials either. From a performance standpoint, what I was going to say is that a hammer does not need to be hard all the way through, nor does an anvil, right? And this is why both hammers and anvils traditionally were made from wrought iron and had steel bases that were forged welded to the working surface, because you only need the hardness in the first quarter of an inch or something like that, and beyond that, it doesn't need to be hard. A hammer like this one doesn't have any fine details. It's not like a chasing hammer or something where it comes to thin cross sections that may need to be extra hard all the way through or something like that. This is just a general forging hammer. So 1045 meets those requirements from a performance standpoint. You can take a piece of 1045, a cross section like this, and heat treat it and get it hard enough, deep enough for it to be an effective tool. If I made the same hammer out of 4140, I would get it to the same hardness, but to a deeper depth within the part. But in the case of a hammer, that doesn't give me any advantage. It certainly does in other applications, and that's why 4140 exists, because there are times when you need those properties. And likewise, there are many other grades that will harden to much deeper depths than 4140. There's a space in the world of steel for all of those things. But in our own shops, we're typically not dealing with something that needs to be hard all the way through for most of our tools. A possible exception to that would be a power hammer die. Because in the case of a power hammer die, you have a lot of repeated hammering over a long period of time, many more blows on a power hammer die than I'll probably ever deliver with a hand hammer. So there, it would make sense to use a steel that can be hard through the full cross section of the die. These dies are about 3x6, so sort of a medium-sized die. If you're dealing with something like a 25-pound hammer, you might have dies that are 2x4 or something of that sort. So in those circumstances, a tool material that will harden all the way through to your desired hardness, at whatever that cross section is going to be a good choice. I'm just going to check this. It's probably not hot enough yet, but no, we've got a ways to go. So the next thing to think about is, well, okay, what steel do I match to what size, right? And there's lots of books and tables and charts and things that I can show you. But for a 4-inch cross section, if that's what you were working with, 4140 will harden all the way through in 4 inches. If you're at 6 or 7 inches, 4340 will do that. If you're at, say, 2 inches, 1045 will do that. So that can give you some guidance on how to make material selection. But that's just on getting hardness all the way through. You also need to think about what resources do you have to heat treat that, and what kind of shape are you heat treating? Because certain shapes are more difficult to heat treat successfully than others, meaning some of them might like to crack. And so one of the advantages to a grade like H13, which is an air hardening steel, sections that we're talking about, is that it's much less prone to cracking during heat treatment because it's air quenching. You heat it up to the correct temperature, you pull it out of the furnace, and you let it just sit. And it will fully harden all the way through in a section 4x4 or 6x6. So, because you don't have to cool it as fast as other steels, you can have more intricate geometries and have less risk of cracking. So that might be a reason to use a grade like H13, even though you don't necessarily need it for performance, it might actually be easier to heat treat. So that might justify the extra cost and expense of working with a material like that. It's certainly not required lots and lots of power anodizing made out of 4340 or even 4140, and they work very well. If you're going to do that, you want to think about the geometry of your tools. And so when you have a power hammer die, most of them have a dovetail. So you have a dovetail. And when you have a dovetail, you have the opportunity to have a sharp inside corner. So this is actually pretty sharp. Sharp inside corners like this, any item, are going to increase the risk of getting a crack right through that area right there. And so a steel which has to be liquid quenched to harden is going to have greater risk of having a crack there than one that doesn't. So you might choose to make that, you could overcome that problem by making just a straight block, and doing your heat treatment, and then cutting your dovetails after heat treatment. If you have the facilities to do that, that can be more challenging because if you're machining a hard piece of steel, you need special tooling and so forth, but it can be done. Or you might choose to alter the geometry of that and create a bigger radius of that inside corner. If you don't need that corner as part of the working design of the tool, what I mean by that is if it's okay for your shoulder, for example, here, if it's okay for this shoulder to be a little higher up on the tool, because maybe, like in this case of this die is going to bottom out on this surface. So exactly where this, as long as this shoulder is high enough, so you're not bottoming out on the shoulder, which would cause, you'd probably break the saw lock if you did that. So as long as you're high enough, you can come up a little higher, make a bigger radius in there, we can machine that, and then heat treat it with a bigger radius and less risk of cracking. So there's different ways to solve these problems. If you're not set up to heat treat something like a die, there's commercial services that you can send your work pieces to, and they can do heat treat for you. If you use a commercial service, they need to know what material you made your tools out of and what your desired hardness is. With that information, they should be able to execute the injury for you. For a power hammer die, I'm sure there are probably different preferences on how hard they should be. You don't want them so hard that there's a risk of chipping. Right? So you certainly wouldn't make them as hard as you'd make it, like a knife blade, for example. That would be too hard for a power hammer die. So if I were making power hammer dies and I have made a few of them, I'd probably be shooting for something around Rockwell 50, which is similar to what a hand hammer face or an anvil face would be. I'd rather have my power hammer die a little softer than is ideal, because if I get a dig or a dig in it, I can more easily clean that up. I'd rather have that happen than have the die fall while I'm using it and have a piece go flying around the shop, which is a safety hazard. I'm sure you would find other people who might say, oh, they want their dies just a little softer, or maybe they like their dies just a little harder. And there's probably space in the world of blacksmithing for that variability and still have good, safe working tools. And you might make adjustments based on how you use your tools. If you're somebody that doesn't do much with auxiliary tooling under the hammer, and you're just using it straight for drawing out, say, Damascus billets, you might be able to get away with a little harder die because you're not ever going to have some tooling driven against that workpiece. One of the things that I sometimes encounter is that people look at an application and and they say, oh, we're doing something at the Ford shop, and it's hot, we have a hot furnace, and we have tools that are coming in contact with hot metal, so we have to use a hot work steel like the HRT I talked about before. And that's not really true, because most hot work tool steels are really only going to show an advantage once you start to get temperatures that are probably over 500 or 600 degrees. So if you make a hammer head out of HRT, it will work fine, provided you can do it correctly. But you're not ever going to get your hammer head 600 degrees while you're holding it in your hand. So you're not going to see the advantage of that material, other than from its ability to be air hardening. You're not going to see any advantage in performance using that material for a hand hammer. And you might say, well, what about like a power hammer? There we've got metal on the dies and so forth. Unfortunately, pretty big pieces of steel at my house, and I don't think I've ever had my power hammer dies at around 600 or 700 degrees. At work, I've seen our dies turn red hot because we're doing a different class of work. And so there we use materials like wasp oil, which is a completely not like it's a cobalt, nickel cobalt alloy, you know, for jet engine turret discs, right? But that's a completely different class of work than what we're dealing with here. I know there's some folks that provide anvils that are made out of H13, and I'm sure that they work great. From a performance standpoint, I don't think that's going to be any better material than what this balsam is made out of, or a pyrite, or any other anvil that's been properly heated out of some other material. We use H13 in those circumstances today because the manufacturer may have access to it. I think the foundry that does that work casts a lot of H13 for other applications. So they have a ready supply, and it's very easy for them to just have a little extra metal in the furnace or their commercial castings for a couple of anvils, and they've got H13 anvils. That's great. Like, there's nothing wrong with doing that. But for me to specify an H13 anvil, I would have to pay a premium over specifying that same anvil cast from some other lower cost material. So let's talk about the tool that we're going to make next. Let's see here. I'm going to make a new drawing. The tool that we're going to make is really quite simple. It's just a block, basically a block with ears on it. The value that this tool has, and I should try to illustrate it, would be as a bending block. So this is a tool that I saw demonstrated in one of Luke DeGrasse's power hammer videos. And what he did with it was he was making a pair of tongs. He was doing a V-bit style tongs like this. So he had something like this. And he had, and I didn't bring it with me, but he had a spring tool, a spring swage that had a top V that matched this and a bottom swage. And he put that tool with the tong into a block like this. And then he took another tool and set it here, and he used that bend the curve into the tong rings for a full jaw style block. That would just be one application of that tool. But I thought that it would make a good example of how we can use side set tools, or butchers, or check tools, or fullers, depending on who you're talking to, these triangular tools here. How we can use these tools to create this type of a profile. Also, how we can control how this metal moves. I want to think about what this metal should do before I forge it. So if I started with a rectangular block, I should have measured it before I put it in the furnace, but we're gonna put side set marks here and here. They're gonna be about 1.25 inches in from the ends. And we're gonna forge down to create a smaller dimension here. Now, when I do that, my I'll call these ears or my tabs, they are gonna bend out away because there's a much more thickness. They're pretty narrow, and this tool is pretty close to the edge. So when this comes down, there's going to be a lot of metal here to support the metal, not much support over here. So this is going to bend out, right? I don't want that to happen. I want this to be straight down. I did a lot of grinding on this one to make it look good and etch it to bring it here. But we are going to try to counteract that behavior by starting on the bottom side, and we're going to put some half round marks. And remember, I just did an example where I flared the workout to create a bevel in the direction I wanted it to go. And we did the same thing for Peter's piece that we passed around. We're going to do the same thing here. We're going to start on the bottom. We're going to flare that out. Then we'll flip it over and put our side set marks in. And if we've done it correctly, hopefully that this will catch up with the bottom. It might not come out quite so perfect as this, but it won't be quite as wonky as this one was that I forced where I didn't do that at home. So to do that, we'll start again with our half round tool. And when we do this process, and I'll do a little forging and then I'll come back and do a little drawing to explain some of the particulars of what's going on. Metal when we forge it using different types of tools. last night, for those who were here, I spent a good bit of time talking about the advantages of forging in certain applications and how by making metal flow around corners, we can get performance advantages that we don't have with other methods of manufacturing. And so my hope is to illustrate that through the use of powder welded material. And that's why I did this one. I etched it pretty heavily so you can see how that metal was moved. Now this one, there are a couple things that are not ideal here. One is I had to do a lot of grinding to clean up some things that got really out of square. So that removed some material that otherwise would have displayed some of that contour. The other thing is that the side set tools that I'm using, they have a radius, but it's not a very big radius. And for a lot of things, that's just fine. In this particular application, I should probably have a much larger radius on these tools. This arrow radius is tending to want to actually cut some of the layers rather than push them around. Now you can see with this big half round, you probably can actually see pretty well what that was hot. This big half round pushed all those layers around. There was no cutting of any layers, right? So I'm just giving you a warning that we may see that cutting happen with these tools. I was thinking of altering that, but I kind of like the radiuses for the other project I have in mind, so I don't want to alter them right now. So we'll just move forward with this and just be aware that we may see a cutting action more than is ideal, and we can correct that with a bigger radius on the tool. Yeah. I do, yeah. So Dave asked about right and left. And so size sets, these two are indeed right and left, and I had to label them because I can't tell the difference without the labels. At work, we don't have right and left side sets. They are same. You can flip-flop them either way. So let's talk about side sets for a minute. So side set, especially one that has a handle like these that we're describing, you're going to use, they have actually a fairly particular geometry. They look like a 45-degree bar, but they're not actually 45 degrees. So they have an appearance of... kind of hard to draw upside down backwards. Okay. It looks like this angle here is 45. Yeah, I'm not going to be able to do that. I am not that good at drawing upside down backwards. That's what it looks like, and that's why I have to have them labeled, because it's not that. What you actually have is that this, or maybe I should have said, this angle here looks like it's 90 degrees. That angle's not 90 degrees. That angle on the tools that I made is actually 83 degrees. Okay? So if that angle is 83 degrees and that angle is 45 degrees, that angle has to be a little bit less than 45 or a little more. The important thing to recognize, and I'm going to just take that off since I'm here, okay? The important thing to know is that the angle between your vertical and your horizontal surfaces is less than 90 degrees. It's 83 degrees in the case of my tools. I've seen some that are 82 and 84, but you definitely want that to be less than 90 on your business surfaces as well, right? The reason why that's important is because when you're forging, if you go to drive the tool in, I have to put this around and draw this and then put it back for you. If you go to drive that tool in, if you don't do that, the tool will kind of dive off in a direction you don't want it to go. Okay. how did I do it? Is that what you asked?
Yeah.
So the way I did it was I took a square bar, cut it at 45 degrees, and then ground it and used an angle, like a protractor, so that I could keep checking until I got it right. Yeah. I'm sure you could machine them, you know.
Thank you.
tool materials. My sunset tools are just whatever scrap I had in the shop there. I'm pretty sure there's some sort of alloy steel because they were little test pieces from work. So they're probably something like 4140 or 4340, but I wasn't too particular. I just grabbed some, in this case, it was just half square and cut it down. So you can see that my the edges are actually tipping in quite a bit. What's happening is as I'm driving those tools down, there's some friction that's actually pulling that metal in. And also, not only is it pulling it in this way, it's also pulling it down this way. In this particular project, I didn't set for myself any predetermined dimensions, so I was trying to hit with the final tool, so that doesn't really matter. But if I had, I would have had to allow for that distortion, start with something taller than that, to account for that decrease in height, or figure out some way to draw that metal back out and square that corner back up if that was important. Often it's easier to start bigger and allow, you know, account for change in dimension with a bigger thing rather than pull metal back in the opposite direction. That's more challenging to do. I feel like there should be some more questions. I'm doing all the talking. What's going on here? Don't make me call on you, Dave. I see Dave there. Okay.
For hammer makers,
yeah.
Do you think that by using the S7 or any material, they are pretty
sure.